Now, in order to speed up the vaccination process in India, two key developments happened today. Government sources have now told NDTV that in order to speed up the approvals for Pfizer, Moderna in India, they're ready to grant them indemnity from liability, which means that companies like Moderna, Pfizer, who apply for emergency use, will be granted protection against legal proceedings along the lines of what's been granted elsewhere as well. The other key waiver, no need for the India-specific trials to be carried out if you have an approval by the WHO for emergency use. So these companies don't have to conduct post-launch bridging trials in the country. But to understand this in detail, let's go across to Vishnu Som. Vishnu, this is good news for the moment, but what does it tell us about the timelines on these vaccines?
Very simply, Sonal, it tells us nothing about the timeline on these vaccines. That's because these vaccines may simply not be present in the numbers that India really wants to bring in to import. There's also the entire cost of how much it's going to cost. Remember, vaccines like Pfizer cost more than $35 a dose. So therefore, if it's going to be imported by the center, is the center actually willing to pay this amount of money? And if so, for what quantity? What has happened really is clarification as far as the policy is concerned. For several months, Moderna and Pfizer, among others, have said, look, please indemnify us. In other words, if there is legal action against us in India, then we want to be protected against that legal action. That sets us back. The government thus far has said, no, if there is a problem, for example, with the medication, people fall unwell, if they go to a court, then you cannot be protected from that. The counter argument from Pfizer has been, no, look, it's the case in so many other parts of the world, and it now appears that the center has agreed, which really does beg the question, if you've agreed now, why didn't you agree earlier on, particularly since vaccines were always in short supply? The second key aspect of all of this, there are supposed to be simultaneous bridging trials as per the new rules, which were to take place after a vaccine like Pfizer or Moderna could come in. So earlier on, they had to actually have trials first, be approved in India. Then the government said that, no, if we grant you emergency use authorization, you can come to India, simultaneously do trials. Now that requirement for trials doesn't exist. So it is a step forward, but are we any closer to knowing when some of these vaccines come in? No.
All right. Thanks, Vishnu, for that. The center's policy, meanwhile, giving free vaccination to the 45-plus age group, but having a paid system for those below, is a prima facie arbitrary and irrational. That's what the Supreme Court said today. In fact, Supreme Court flagged several other flaws as well, like including shortage of vaccine doses and problems faced by rural people in accessing these vaccines. The court asked the center to review its vaccination policy altogether and place before the court a roadmap of projected availability of vaccines till the 31st of December 2021. Apart from that, pricing also came up in these discussions. Supreme Court saying, how is 35,000 crore budget for vaccine procurement being spent? Submit a comparison of prices of vaccines in India and their international prices. Also submit data on centers' purchase history of COVID vaccines. And also, they said, respond to preparedness if the third wave impacts children. So Supreme Court coming down very heavy and asking some tough questions to the center. This as we continue to look at COVID figures, which at the moment continue to show a declining trend. The past 24 hours, the cases were up by a minor 4%, though, 1,32,000 over there. Deaths were up as well, this by 12.8%. Vaccination down at this point, 13.8%. And tests in the past 24 hours up as well by 4.6%. But the positivity rate overall below 10% for the 9th straight day. 9,346 children were either abandoned, orphaned or lost a parent to COVID-19 pandemic. That's what the National Commission for Protection of Child's Rights told the Supreme Court. And these, remember, are just the reported figures till the May 29th. In Uttar Pradesh, 200 kids have lost both parents, and further, 1,800 children has lost at least one parent. Both the center and Adityanath government have announced schemes for such children. But is that enough? How will they cope? Alok Pandey explores.
मतलब कोविड में पिछले साल लॉकडाउन हुआ था तो हम लोग बहुत खुश रहे घर पे, हमेशा बिल्कुल खुश रहते थे। इस साल वो चीज़ हुई जो मैंने कभी नहीं सोची थी।
दिस 14-year-old गर्ल फ्रॉम वेस्टर्न यूपीज हापुड़, वन अमंग द स्टेट्स मेनी कोविड ऑर्फन्स, द फेसेस ऑफ इमेंस ट्रेजेडी इन इंडियाज मोस्ट पॉपुलर स्टेट। A month ago, this girl lost both her parents to COVID just a week apart. Her father ran a small shop selling Ayurvedic medicines. Her mother was a homemaker.
28 को सुबह सुबह हम लोगों को पता लगा था कि मेरे फादर की डेथ हो गई है। तो फिर किसी तरह हमने मेरी मदर को मतलब नहीं बताया था, बट किसी तरह फिर हमने वो सारी चीज़ें आगे मतलब आगे बढ़ाई सारी, क्योंकि मेरी मदर को क्योर करना था हमें। अब सिर्फ दादी, मेरी दादी और दादू जी हैं, उनके साथ में रहती हूँ। उनकी भी एज बहुत ज़्यादा है। अब मुझे गवर्नमेंट से बस इतनी फैसिलिटी चाहिए कि गवर्नमेंट मेरी पढ़ाई का खर्चा उठाए।
लाइक द 14-year-old गर्ल, एट लीस्ट 200 अदर चिल्ड्रन have lost both their parents to COVID in UP, while a further 1,800 kids have lost at least one parent, the UP government says. 200 kilometers from Hapur, in Bareilly, these young children from a middle-class business family are yet to come to terms with the trauma of losing both their parents within hours of each other in the last week of April.
कंटिन्यू 27 को हम लोग रात के 11:30 बजे तक घूमते हैं, लेकिन मम्मी पापा को बेड अवेलेबल नहीं मिला कहीं भी। और 28 को भी फिर मम्मी पापा को दीपमाला हॉस्पिटल में मिला, लेकिन मम्मी की कार में ही मम्मी की डेथ हो गई। मम्मी को हम लोग नहीं बचा पाए। और पापा का भी 28 की रात को पापा का भी दीपमाला हॉस्पिटल में ही हो गया, रात में उसी सेम डे 11:30-12 पे पापा को भी नहीं बचा पाया।
The tragedy is even more stark in rural Uttar Pradesh, where in many cases, breadwinners in families have died. Despite promises of government help, the future does look bleak. 650 kilometers from Bareilly, in East UP's Balia, these four children have just lost their mother, a daily wager, to COVID. Their father died of cancer many years ago. The eldest child is just 13. The youngest is 7 years old.
आपका पढ़ाई का फीस कौन भरेगा?
भगवान जाना।
पढ़ने का मन है ना?
हाँ।
क्या बनना चाहते हैं पढ़ के?
पुलिस।
अगर दोनों माँ बाप नहीं हैं उनके और कोई लीगल गार्जियन नहीं मिलता है, तो हमारा यहाँ पे शेल्टर होम है और महिला बाल विकास कमेटी, चाइल्ड वेलफेयर कमेटी के समक्ष हम उनको प्रस्तुत करके और उनको शेल्टर होम में रखवाएंगे, और 18 साल तक ये प्रावधान है।
450 किलोमीटर अवे इन चित्रकूट, दिस 70-year-old is worried about taking care of her grandchildren. A 9-year-old boy and a 6-year-old girl. After their mother, a daily wager, died of COVID, the father of the children lives separately in Madhya Pradesh.
पिता आपका गलत है।
नहीं, क्या कहते हैं लेने के लिए? क्या
नहीं आ रहे हैं? कोई पता नहीं है।
मतलब बच्चों की
ना,
बच्चों की सुध नहीं ले रहे हैं क्या?
हाँ, ना कोई फोन करते हैं, ना कोई आते हैं, ना कोई बातचीत।
After Prime Minister Modi announced help for India's COVID orphans, the UP government has said it will help too.
गार्जियन या केयरटेकर से अनाथ होने वाले उन बच्चों की देखभाल के लिए राज्य सरकार ऐसे बच्चों को, यानी जब तक वो बच्चे अपने पैरों पर खड़े होते हैं, ऐसे बच्चों की देखभाल के लिए 4,000 रुपए प्रति बच्चा वित्तीय सहायता उपलब्ध कराएगी। 10 साल से कम आयु के ऐसे बच्चे जिनके गार्जियन या उनका कोई अभिभावक नहीं है, ऐसे बच्चों को राज्य सरकार के द्वारा जो संचालित हैं बाल गृह, उनके संरक्षण की व्यवस्था, उनके आवास की व्यवस्था होगी।
ओवर टाइम द गवर्नमेंट परहैप्स नीड्स टू मॉनिटर इंडियाज कोविड ऑर्फन्स सो दैट गवर्नमेंट स्कीम्स कैन एक्चुअली रीच देम एंड देयर ट्रॉमा इश्यूज आर ऑल्सो एड्रेस्ड। With Adnan, Randeep, Parvez, Karuna and camera person Vineet Verma, this is Alok Pandey, NDTV.
Now, as cases in India show a downward trend, at least in some parts of the country, and unlocking happening in some metros now, bus stations and railway platforms have a worrying sense of deja vu. Migrants, mostly from UP, Bihar, Bengal, are back. but their future in the city still doubtful and very uncertain.
Anand Vihar railway station in East Delhi is buzzing once again. With the relaxation in the lockdown, migrants from UP, Bihar and West Bengal are now slowly beginning to return. Some in search of a livelihood and others hoping to return to jobs they held earlier.
कहाँ से आ रहे हैं?
बिहार से आ रहे हैं.
बिहार में कहाँ से?
सीतामढ़ी से.
सीतामढ़ी. कब गए थे आप सीतामढ़ी?
10 तारीख गए थे.
10 मई में?
हाँ जी.
तो क्या लॉकडाउन के चलते ही गए थे?
हाँ जी, काम धंधा बंद हो चला गया था.
क्या काम करते हैं आप यहाँ पर?
एक्सपोर्ट में.
अच्छा, एक्सपोर्ट में है. अच्छा, काम धंधे बंद हो गए थे तो इसलिए जो है.
हाँ, अब धीरे धीरे खुल रहा है तो उसके बाद फिर जा रहा हूँ. यहाँ थोड़ा गाड़ी का प्रॉब्लम है बस उसकी, तब रिजर्व करना पड़ेगा या कोई ऐसी.
एक्सपोर्ट फैक्ट्री में काम करते हो?
हाँ, एक्सपोर्ट फैक्ट्री में.
अच्छा, तो क्या नौकरी पक्की है या आप जाके फिर काम ढूंढेंगे?
नहीं, पक्की नहीं है, ढूंढना पड़ेगा जाके.
नरेंद्र कुमार लेफ्ट फॉर हिज होम टाउन इन मार्च दिस ईयर बिफोर द शटडाउन. मेमोरीज ऑफ लास्ट ईयर्स लॉकडाउन स्टिल हॉन्ट डेली वेज वर्कर्स लाइक हिम, who left Delhi early this year in March, fearing that they would be left alone without a livelihood and to fend for themselves.
अब किस उम्मीद के साथ अब वापस आए हैं? जब दिल्ली आ गए हैं आप?
जी, पेट के लिए आया हूँ.
पेट के लिए?
क्या करें सर.
Many daily wage workers shifted to hawking vegetables in the lockdown to eke a living, as this was the only trade allowed by the government.
ना पुलिस सब मारता था डंडा से ना.
अच्छा,
बेचने नहीं देता था ना.
अच्छा, तो कहाँ था? गुरुग्राम में आप बेचते थे? कौन से सेक्टर में?
तो सब जगह लगा, हाथ फुला दिया, गर्दन में मारा था, सब भाग गया.
एंड नाउ एज कोविड केसेस डिप एंड नॉर्म्स आर रिलैक्स्ड, माइग्रेंट्स आर स्लोली बिगनिंग टू रिटर्न टू द बिग सिटीज एज द व्हील्स ऑफ द इकोनॉमी बिगिन टू टर्न वंस अगेन. विद शरद शर्मा इन दिल्ली, हर्षा कुमारी सिंह, NDTV.
एंड विद द अनलॉक एंड द माइग्रेंट्स, गेस व्हाट रिटर्न टू द सिटीज एज वेल. Roads filled with chaos, massive traffic jams, huge crowds, fewer masks, and practically no social distancing. Have we really learnt no lessons from the second wave? This story explores.
Chaos as India reopens after weeks of COVID restrictions. Huge crowds, few masks, and no social distancing. At the famous Ma Vindhyavasini temple in East UP's Mirzapur that reopened on Monday after 51 days of COVID restrictions. In Azamgarh, also in East UP, a big traffic jam at this main town intersection just hours after restrictions were eased. In Madhya Pradesh's Shajapur, a stampede-like situation outside the government seed corporation warehouse where farmers gathered for soya bean seeds on day one of relaxations in the corona curfew in MP. In Jammu, the biggest crowds at wine shops like this one that also opened after a month. With Anurag Dwari, this is Alok Pandey, NDTV.
Moving on, no board examinations for CBSE and ICSE students, but the relief from that was only short-lived. There is still no clarity on what next. How will the evaluation be done? How will the grading happen? How will college cutoffs be decided? Will there be an entrance exam instead? And what about the state boards? Questions that are still not being answered.
17-year-old class 12 students Aryan and Ankit are happy they don't have to take board exams, but worried about their future and the way they will be graded in the absence of board exams.
Sir, 11th mein mera to bahut hi bekar result tha. Nahi, mujhe nahi pata ki kya hoga, marks kaise lenge wo log.
Over lakhs of students in India are now uncertain about the next few months. How will they get admission into college? Which college? Will their results come in time? The CBSE is working on two options for marking class 12 students. The first option is to assess students on performances in class 10, 11 final exams and class 12 internal exams. And the second option is to assess them on the basis of class 10 board exam results and internal assessments in class 12th. The secretary of CBSE told NDTV that they will need 2 weeks to prepare the evaluation criteria.
मैं डेट्स के बारे में कंफर्म आपको नहीं कर रहा हूं क्योंकि उसमें थोड़ा समय लग सकता है, तो इट मे बी टेंटेटिवली 2 weeks टाइम. देखिए, अगर आप टेंटेटिव टाइम लेकर के चलें तो कंट्री के जो हमारी यूनिवर्सिटीज हैं, जो कॉलेजेस हैं, अगस्त में नॉर्मली उनकी प्रोसेस स्टार्ट होती है. तो फॉरेन स्कूल्स के भी जो ऑफर बच्चों के लिए आ रहे हैं वो अगस्त की बात कर रहे हैं. ये प्रोसेस स्टार्ट होने के पहले हमारी मार्कशीट बच्चों के हाथ में होगी.
स्टूडेंट्स डिससैटिस्फाइड विद देयर क्लास 12th मार्क्स एंड वांट टू अपीयर इन एन एग्जाम विल बी गिवन अ चांस टू इंप्रूव देयर स्कोर्स व्हेन द कोविड सिचुएशन इंप्रूव्स.
बट एज ऑफ नाउ नो क्लैरिटी फ्रॉम सीबीएसई एंड स्टूडेंट्स आर सेइंग दे आर रिलीव्ड बट स्टिल एंग्शियस अबाउट देयर मार्किंग्स. In New Delhi with Rakesh Saurabh Shukla for NDTV.
Meanwhile, NDTV also spoke with the VC of Delhi University to understand if they had a plan, and they believe that they will be basing their admissions on grades by CBSE.
भारत सरकार ने जो फैसला लिया है कि इस वर्ष 12वीं की परीक्षा नहीं लेंगे, भारत सरकार के इस निर्णय के साथ हमारी इन सब कमिटीज की निश्चित बैठक होगी और उसमें जो भी इस परिस्थिति के कारण उत्पन्न स्थितियों में जो भी सर्वोत्तम निर्णय होगा वो हम लेंगे ताकि स्टूडेंट्स को कम से कम परेशानी हो. उसके साथ ही हम ये भी ध्यान रखेंगे कि जो मेरिट के बेस पर हम एडमिशन लेते हैं उसके साथ हम कोई समझौता भी नहीं करने वाले. किसी न किसी आधार पर सीबीएसई उनको मार्क्स जरूर देगी, तो वो जो मार्क्स हैं वो भी हमारे लिए मेरिट का काम कर सकते हैं. उसमें भी हम मेरिट के स्टूडेंट्स ज़्यादा मेरिट और कम मेरिट पे कर सकते हैं.
All right, so we wait for more details on that. But moving on for now. He's a prime accused in one of India's biggest bank frauds, 14,000 crore in the PNB scam case. But how soon will Mehul Choksi be brought to face trial in India? There have been lots of developments on this story, but the answer at this moment might lie in the Dominican High Court hearing that was underway today. A hearing where CBI and ED officials are also present. And Neeta joins us now for the very latest. Neeta, is there any clarity on timeline on in this case? And in the case of legality over here, is it possible that there could be a favorable hearing from the Indian official side?
See, India hopes that it's going to be a favorable hearing because India has been stressing on the fact that Mehul Choksi is a fugitive and he has been, you know, misrepresenting facts, and based on those facts, he had acquired Antiguan citizenship. In fact, the ED is making a case point that he had not renunciated his citizenship, which is very essential if he wanted to take an Antiguan citizenship. So, India is obviously banking on this fact that he's a fugitive and we need him back to, you know, make their case more strong. India bank statements, the ED officials, the CBI officials have been pasting notices at his residence in Mumbai. That's how India wants to prove that he is a wanted criminal as far as India is concerned. But as far as his legal team is concerned, they clearly say the Indian constitution establishes the minute a person, you know, takes on a citizenship from abroad or from any other country, his Indian citizenship ceases. So, because India believes in dual citizenship, so obviously it does not hold account. So, they are banking on that. And they are also building their case on the fact that Mehul Choksi was abducted from Antigua and taken to Dominica. And if his legal team proves so, that indeed he was abducted from Antigua and taken to Dominica, then the court is obviously going to send him back to Antigua. But India is focusing on the fact that they need to deport him back because he had entered Dominica illegally. He's an illegal migrant there. So both the sides are trying to present their case. The case is going on right now. Mehul Choksi is present in the court hearing through a Zoom meeting. He's going online and hearing the case. Sonal?
With Olympic champion Carolina Martin out of the Tokyo field due to injury, India's tallest star and silver medalist in badminton from Rio, PV Sindhu, becomes an overwhelming gold medal favorite in Japan. Now, she is the only Indian in the badminton women's singles. Saina Nehwal has not qualified. So, NDTV spoke with her, trying to understand what were the pressures and preparations looking like.
it's nothing like pressure, but or the expectation, but it's just that obviously people want that medal, they want that medal, and since I got a medal at Rio, even in Tokyo, everybody would want me to expect, everybody would expect that that I need to get a better medal this time, change the color. So I would not say it, there might be pressure, but for me it's just that I need to go into the court with my, just be focused and give my 100%. Yeah, that's it.
All right, good luck to her then. And finally, let's bring you our COVID heroes. This one in Mohali, where officials adopted a village for vaccination. They actually put in a sponsorship scheme in place and the village got together to get some money and vaccinate the people in the area.
Masol village, 25 kilometers from Mohali, adopted for vaccination.
ਸਾਡੇ ਇੱਥੇ ਸ਼ਹਿਰ ਨੇੜੇ ਨਹੀਂ ਪੈਂਦਾ ਹੈ, ਹਸਪਤਾਲ ਦੂਰ ਪੈਂਦਾ ਜੀ, 2-4 ਕਿਲੋਮੀਟਰ ਦੂਰ ਆ ਸਾਡਾ, ਇੱਥੇ ਸਰਕਾਰ ਨੇ ਕੈਂਪ ਲਗਾਇਆ ਜੀ.
As deaths increased in rural areas and vaccine shortage grew, this young IAS officer started a new initiative.
हमने ये स्टार्ट तो हमने अपने ऑफिस से ही किया कि 5-6 ऑफिसर्स हम लोगों ने इकट्ठे होकर हमने कहा कि हम एक विलेज की वैक्सीनेशन स्पॉन्सर कर देते हैं.
A donor pays 430 rupees for a single dose for one individual. Private hospitals are paying 1000 rupees for one dose of Covaxin, but the government gets it for 430 rupees. Donations are being deposited in a bank account. A study in the district that showed only one of the 953 COVID deaths was after both doses has done much to reduce vaccine hesitancy. Adopt a village for vaccination is now picking pace, and within 2 weeks, 13 villages have been covered through multiple donations. In Chandigarh, with Mohammad Ghazali, Joshua Chin for NDTV.